196 ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿರುವ ಕನ್ನಡಿಗರನ್ನ ಒಂದಾಗಿಸುವುದೇ ನಮ್ಮ ರೇಡಿಯೋ.
ಜಗತ್ತಿನಾದ್ಯಂತ ಇರುವಂತಹ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕನ್ನಡಿಗರಿಗೆ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ಹೋಪ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಗುಡ್ ಈವ್ನಿಂಗ್. ಇದು ಮೋಟ್ ಫಿನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸಸ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಮನಿ ಟಾಕ್ಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಮೀ ಪೂಜಾ, ಅಂಡ್ ನನ್ನ ಜೊತೆ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಸೀನಿಯರ್ ಫಿನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಕನ್ಸಲ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಅಪೂರ್ವ ಬೋರಾ. ಫಸ್ಟ್ಲಿ ಈ ಶೋಗೆ ನಿಮ್ ಕಡೆಯಿಂದ ಬಂದಿರೋ ರೆಸ್ಪಾನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಪ್ರಿಸಿಯೇಷನ್ಗೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು. ಕೆಲವೊಬ್ರು ಶೋ ಕೇಳಿದ ನಂತರ ನಮಗ್ ಮೆಸೇಜ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದೀರಾ, ನಿಮ್ಮ ಫಿನಾನ್ಸ್ ರಿಲೇಟೆಡ್ ಡೌಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ಸ್ ನ ಕಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೀರಾ. ಹೋಪ್ಫುಲಿ ನಮ್ ಕಡೆಯಿಂದ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರೋ ಟಿಪ್ಸ್ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಪ್ಲಾನಿಂಗ್ಗೆ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ಕೋತಾ ಇದೀನಿ. ಅಂಡ್ ಈ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಶೋ ಆಸ್ ದ ನೇಮ್ ಸೇಸ್, ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಫಿನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಷನ್ಸ್ ನ ನಡೆಸ್ತೀವಿ. ಎಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ಇವಾಗಿರುವಂತಹ ಅನ್ಪ್ರೆಸಿಡೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಟೈಮ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ವೆಲ್ತ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವೆಲ್ತ್ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಕೂಡ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ಸ್ ಸಚ್ ಆಸ್ ರಿಟೈರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಪ್ಲಾನಿಂಗ್, ಫಾರಿನ್ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್, ಸಕ್ಸೆಷನ್ ಪ್ಲಾನಿಂಗ್, ಈ ತರ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ಸ್ ನ ಇನ್ ಲೆಂತ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಅಂಡ್ ಈ ಫೀಲ್ಡ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪರ್ಟೈಸ್ ಇರುವಂತಹ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಜನರನ್ನ ನಾವು ಮಾತಾಡಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೀವಿ. ಇದನ್ನ ನೀವು ಮಿಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ರೆ ನಮ್ ರೇಡಿಯೋ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಚಾನಲ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗಿ ಮನಿ ಟಾಕ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಸರ್ಚ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ನಿಮ್ ಕನ್ವೀನಿಯಂಟ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರೀವಿಯಸ್ಲಿ ಡನ್ ಎಪಿಸೋಡ್ಸ್ ನ ನೀವು ಕೇಳಬಹುದು. ಐ ಆಮ್ ಶೋರ್ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಅದು ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಆಗತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ. ಅಂಡ್ ಕಮಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಟುಡೇಸ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್, ಇವತ್ತು ನಾವು ಒಂದ್ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ನ ಚೂಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದೀವಿ ರೆಗ್ಯುಲರ್ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ಸ್ ಗಿಂತ. ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಈಕ್ವಿಟಿ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಫಾರ್ HNIs. ಸೊ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ನನಗೂ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಹೊಸದು. ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನನ್ನ ಗೈಡ್ ಮಾಡಕ್ಕೆ, ನಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲ ಲಿಸ್ನರ್ಸ್ಗೆ ಇದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಶನ್ ಕೊಡಕ್ಕೆ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಅಪೂರ್ವ ಬೋರಾ ಇರ್ತಾರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಜೊತೆ. ಅಂಡ್ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ನಮ್ಮ ಗೆಸ್ಟ್ ಮಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಸೂರಜ್ ನಾಯರ್, ಹೂಸ್ ದ ಕೋ ಫೌಂಡರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಚೀಫ್ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಫೀಸರ್ ಅಟ್ ಮೋಟ್ ಫಿನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸಸ್ ಪ್ರೈವೇಟ್ ಲಿಮಿಟೆಡ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಇವರು ಇಕ್ವಿಟಿ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ನ ಇನ್ ಅ ಲಾರ್ಜರ್ ಸ್ಕೇಲ್ ಫಾರ್ ಲಾರ್ಜರ್ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಅವ್ರು ಹ್ಯಾಂಡಲ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಮೋಟ್ ಕಂಪನಿ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಸೆಮಿ ಲೈಸೆನ್ಸ್ಡ್ ಪೋರ್ಟ್ಫೋಲಿಯೋ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಕಂಪನಿ, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಕೊಚ್ಚಿನ್, ಫ್ರಮ್ 6 to 7 ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ನಡೆಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅವರು ನಮ್ ಜೊತೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಜೆಂಟಲ್ಮೆನ್, ಗುಡ್ ಈವ್ನಿಂಗ್, ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ಗುಡ್ ಈವ್ನಿಂಗ್, ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
Mr. Suraj, I'm very happy to have you on our show today.
Thank you, Pooja, and thank you, Abhubha, for having me here. And thank you, Namaste. Yeah.
Firstly, I would like to say that I'm a big fan of Malayalam movies, actually.
That's fascinating. So, in fact, we are on a different medium right now.
Yeah, correct. So, Apurva sir, what's today's topic? And can you please guide me about today's topic, since it's very new to me also?
Yes. So, Pooja, today's topic is interesting because today we have chosen the equity investing what most of the high net worth individuals prefer, which is the portfolio management services. And we felt that in this space, let's have somebody who has spent a lot of time managing very, very interesting large investor families and all. So, so welcoming Suraj, you know, it's very nice to talk to you on this medium today while we have spoken many times on various other mediums, but quite excited to have you on the show today for this thing, Suraj.
Thank you, Apurva, and thank you, Namma Radio, for giving me such an opportunity.
So, Suraj, it would be good if you know, we start with a very simple, very typical question that we begin with always. We want to know something about your life journey and what made you take up the fund management as a profession.
Yeah, Apurva, in fact, I started my career in softwares and software development because I'm basically an engineer by academics. And my coming into the scene of equity investment is just an accident, because I must tell you, I was having a pretty good time, you know, developing software for different financial companies, or for that matter, developing financial products in a software way and those kind of things as such. But all of a sudden, I lost my father way back in 2003, and I had to resign my job. Come back to my hometown in Trivandrum, Kerala, because my mom was all alone. And because of several reasons like dot-com bubble and those kind of things, the industry was getting tough. And with my experience, I was finding it hard to get a second job into software. So I can say that I was sitting idle for around 6 to 7 months. At that point of time, I managed to see a newspaper advertisement whereby a portfolio management services companies were looking for people, you know, in the relationship managers. That's how I got into this company. I'm not mentioning the name over here. It's a very popular portfolio management company in Kerala, and I started my career as a relationship manager. But ever since then, there was no looking back. And when I resigned from this company in 2009, I was promoted to the designation of Vice President Investments. So that has been my journey, because I was largely supported by a bull market that happened from 2002 to 2003 to 2008 and 2009, and then the Lehman crisis came. So that's when I resigned my job and I said enough is enough, because life was getting tough for me and equity was a new subject. I was over a longer period of time, I was trying to adapt to it, but suddenly there comes a full stop in my career. So that's how I decided that no more with equity investment. But one thing I'll tell you, I have spent a lot of time on equities from 2003 to 2009. So I didn't have any other place to go. So finally, I have to find a career in this industry itself. So that's how I became an investor, because, you know, I thought I'll never run an equity investment firm, because it is very unpredictable. It is very volatile. So I'll become an investor. So that's how I started my investing career. And I've been an investor into Indian equity markets for the next 2 to 3 years. And that's how one of my friends, whom I know for a larger period of time, offered me an opportunity, like, why don't we start something on our own? Because there are a lot of people who wanted my service, who was taking my advices. So I thought, why don't we practice in a very legal way? That's how we thought of Mortgage Services, the portfolio management company, and we incorporated the company in 2013 and we started our operations by 2014. So that's my long journey in equities.
Excellent. And Suraj, I've always maintained that people who come from the software background, they are much better in terms of their analytical skill sets, which you already have proved in one field. And you were just converting that into the field of finance, which was, of course, very interesting. Right. But then a little macro question that I have now. Indians as an investing community in general have traditionally chosen physical assets over the financial assets. Now, do you see that this landscape is changing? And, you know, over the next decade, how do you see this landscape actually shape up?
See, ever since I started my career in equities, the process of investing in equities was cumbersome. You needed to fill up a lot of papers, a lot of physical documents has to be done. You know, you need to get a PAN card, because getting a PAN card was a fancy thing way back in 2002 or 2003. But now, if you look at it, all these documents are there by default in an investor's kitty or on an individual's kitty. And moreover, everybody has got an access to a bank account, right? The banking has been the backbone of equity investment. Though equity is a different asset class altogether, everything starts with the bank account, because the money has to be transferred, the money has to be invested, the money has to be paid in, and money has to be paid out. So the bank was the real backbone. You could call it as a nervous system which supported the entire equity market success. So now, with the financial inclusion coming in and Jan Dhan programs and a lot of other activities as well as awareness, the bank accounts, most of the people in India are covered, most of the middle class, I must say that, the middle class in India or middle class and above people are covered by bank accounts. So that made it much more easier for people to invest in. Then the digital technologies came in, you know. So you had apps, you have a lot of payment services, companies like Paytm coming in, because there we already have a set of KYC that we have complied to, you know. So equity investment was just a extension to that, right? So the technology as well as the environment supports equity as an investment class. That is one thing. Second thing is the lucrativeness of other physical assets are also coming down, right? Because if you look at the real estate, we know that it's already an overvalued system, and the kind of rental yields that they provide is not up to the mark. And you know, there have been a lot of, and you must know that the construction industry is also getting into the organized stuff. So there are a lot of companies moving out of the system as well. So now it is no more a profitable business, it is just a commoditized business, just like an FMCG business. So the lucrativeness of the real estate industry is also coming out. Then the fixed deposit interest rate is also going down. So this makes a perfect environment for people to look at other investment options, whereby you will get a much better returns compared to a fixed deposit or a real estate investment as such. That's where equity comes in. And moreover, the climate of business is also changing, because after all, equity investment is buying businesses that you see around. Like equity is now a gambling subject as such. It is not a speculative asset. It is an asset whereby you are taking ownership in businesses that provide services and products to you. So with lot of blogs and new generation investors coming in, the awareness and knowledge about equities have also increased. So there are several factors that support electronic investments like equity assets rather than physical assets.
Yes, so you touched upon the word volatility, so I have something around that only. Given the history of volatility in Indian markets, do you think it will continue to attract new investors?
Apurva, if we look at the history of other developed market like that of Britain or for that matter France, Germany or US, see, everybody went through such a phase. You know, everybody went through such a phase because once your market or the companies are lesser in size, then the volatility of the market increases. Moreover, India is a peculiar country because if you look at a normal, I mean, middle-sized company in India, if you look at the shareholding pattern of a middle-sized company in India, you will realize that 50 to 60 and even in some cases 70 to 75% of the shareholding of the company still lies with the promoter. Whereas if you look at a similar company in a developed market like US or France or Germany for that matter, there would be the promoter could be holding a maximum of 15 to 20%. The rest will be held by institutional shareholders or insurance companies or pension funds, etc., etc., and retail investors too. Because what ultimately affects equity volatility in equity markets is the amount of tradable shares. You call it as free float in technical terms. So if you look at an Indian company, whatever is over and above the shareholding of the promoter is called a free float or the free shares, which is tradable in the market. So the size of the free float is very less in India. That makes the Indian equity markets much more volatile than any other comparable market. But as we move forward, as developments and advancements comes into Indian equity markets, and when all these companies that are listed in the equity markets are subject to a lot of regulations and compliance, as the compliance and regulations come stronger, there will be a call for the promoters to reduce their shareholding and increase the public and free float. So at that point of time, India will just like any other equity markets will mutate from what you call as a volatile market to a much more mature market as we move forward. And I think we are in the cusp of that. Maybe in another 10 to 15 years, we could see that.
Excellent. Yes, that is very, very true. But that also you spoke about how the free float works and how in international markets, the promoters holding is much less. And absolutely, yes. But that brings to one more reference to foreign investors here. There's been a strong perception that FIIs drive the market to a very large extent. This is what a common man on the street will always keep talking about. Can you throw some light on role and impact of what FIIs can have on Indian markets?
See, basically, if you look at the Indian markets, we do not have a large domestic investors. So it is true that we are slaves of foreign institutional investors. The amount or the quantum of money that they pump in is directly proportional to the rise in stock markets and vice versa as well. We cannot deny that fact. But having said that, it would be naive to think that the FII inflows into the equity markets are temporary, because in fact, if you look at the global economies, because of a lot of issues that we talk about, now we talk about the pandemic as well, earlier it was other reasons, the attractiveness of investing into those set of markets has become less lucrative compared to an emerging market. When I say emerging market, you have Brazil, you have India, you have Korea, you have Russia, you have China. Compared to these set of markets, investments in other developed market has become less lucrative. So this has prompted, or say you could say the right word could be tempted, the foreign institutional investors to look into other greener patches like China or India. That is where, because if I may explain it in a different sense, if you look at the company called Facebook, Facebook is obviously listed in NASDAQ, that is in US equity markets where all the technology companies are invested. But if Facebook feels that the bulk of their business is going to come from an emerging economy like India, then the foreign institutional investors are tempted to go directly into the Indian market, because that is the best way to play Facebook in India. So India as an emerging market offers a great opportunity because a lot of industries in India are underpenetrated and most of the companies are just trying to make a mark here, and we are just seeing the tip of the iceberg. So all the foreign institutional investors or the foreign money would like to utilize this opportunity by investing into equities of such businesses in India to make a sizable profit and wealth.
Yes, very, very interesting, Suraj. So, so all these macro factors will obviously have its own impact in terms of how do you take decisions in your profession. So let's come to your professional part of it. Just for the audience of NUM Radio, if you can explain what is PMS and how investors benefit from professional equity management if you are an HNI or in this fashion.
Yeah, right. See, PMS is basically the expansion of, we have a very strange meaning to that because in most of the countries it is called as wealth management services, but whereas in India it is designated as portfolio management services. But I must tell all the listeners to our NUM Radio that portfolio management services is nothing related to photos portfolio, you know, snaps or something like that. It's basically a portfolio of quality Indian businesses.
Yeah.
Basically, portfolio management is ideal for those people who bring in a serious money. I must differentiate here because, you know, if you look at the culture of Indians, we just discussed another question that why Indians are averse to electronic assets compared to physical assets. If you look at an above average Indian middle class, see, they would love to spend 50 lakhs or 1 crore on an apartment. But when it comes to equity investments, they don't put that much of amount into equities. Where they will invest only 5 lakhs or 10 lakhs, a small, meager amount of money only comes to equities as of now. So in case if somebody feels that this is a serious asset and they want to bring in a sizable amount, which could be 50 lakhs or above, they could seek the advice or a support of a portfolio manager. Then who is the portfolio manager? Portfolio management is ideal for those investors who doesn't have the time or knowledge to manage equity investments on their behalf. Because equity investments, you need to study a lot of companies, their balance sheets, their cash flow statements, then the profit and loss sheets. So a bit of accounting and a bit of finance comes into play. So equity investment is simple, but it's not easy. You need to spend a lot of time with equities. You need to understand the culture of equities. You need to have patience. You need to spend time. You need to understand the business of companies that are listed in the Indian stock exchanges. So it amounts a lot of work involved. So in case if you want to put in your success money, but at the same time you do not have the time and knowledge to manage that, you could very well outsource your investments to a portfolio manager. Right? Portfolio manager, just like your lawyer or doctor, you absolutely trust him. And it is up to the portfolio manager to find an opportunity in the markets and invest money where the opportunity is, then pump in those profits back to investors' account and report to him on a periodic basis. This is the spirit of portfolio management, and it has been working well with all HNIs because it has been much more personalized compared to a mutual fund or investing directly, because you have somebody to manage your portfolio, so you don't have to spend time. If you are a doctor, you can very well go and do your surgeries or be in hospitals treating patients and don't worry about the market as much. The person called portfolio manager does have all the character and knowledge to negotiate all the violences that is happening around. So you are free from all those activities and you can very well manage your own business. That's how PMS helps a normal investor, or you can say HNI investor in this way.
Very true. So we keep on saying that this is a ideal product for somebody who is money rich and time poor.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. In a sense, yes. And you can call that, see, basically, if you look at the person who has a physical asset of maybe 1 crore or 2 crore, he is also eligible to invest 50 lakhs. But at the same time, his mindset is not prepared to invest 50 lakhs. That's a difference here. So if you need to create a real wealth, I mean, sizable wealth in equities, because it has proved that it has been one of the best wealth generation assets class, then you need to pump in serious money just like you buy an apartment.
Very true. So now, you know, PMS is understood. Let's take, because we'll otherwise run short of time. So let me come to a question which everybody would want to know about. Is what's your take on equity markets from a long-term perspective? Because we all know short-term, very short-term, no one can predict. But what's your view on equity markets in general? And when I say this, I mean Indian equity markets only.
Right. If I need to answer that question, I must explain to all the listeners here what equities is all about. See, equity is basically ownership of businesses. See, if I may simplify it, while you drive your car, you might see that there are a lot of companies that you see around. You might see the board of Asian Paints, you might see the board of Fevicol, or you might see a hoarding of the car maker called Mahindra and Mahindra or Tata Motors. See, basically, equities is buying these businesses. So when you buy one equity of a company called Tata Motors that is listed in Indian equity markets, you are part partner of that business to the tune of one shares. Say suppose you buy 50 lakh worth of shares in a company called Asian Paints, that means you are owning the part of the business of Asian Paints to the tune of 50 lakhs. So that is the real spirit of equity investment, or that is the real culture of equity investment. So let's look equity investing as investing into business. So what does a businessman do? When he starts a business, there will be a longer time frame that he need to have as far as generating profits is concerned. So you need to give a sizable time so that the business can reward you at a later stage. So it takes almost a time. Now we hear this pandemic every now and then. We know that the most of the business have been shut for the last 3 to 4 months, right? So expecting those company to make an earning or a profit at this point of time will be a foolish ask. So what we need to do, we need to give the company some time so that they generate a sizable profit and revenue moving forward. So when you invest in equities, you should consider as if you are starting a business, and you should give it an ample time so that the business can be rewarded, and that will be reflected in the stock price as you move forward. So if you need to profit from your equity investments, you need to give it ample time, just like the way you give your business time for it to generate profits and revenues.
Very nicely summed up, because this is most often the most common thing for an investor to understand, but most of the people miss out as well. So I think you summed it up really very nicely, Suresh. Pooja, you would want to take up any viewer question now?
Yes, sir, absolutely. Firstly, you changed the name and the meaning of portfolio to me. And as Mr. Suresh said, the only portfolio I knew was of the photos and other things. So I'm happy to know that there is much more beyond that. So my question would be, until now we discussed about investors who have some experience in this field. So what about young investors? Because as youngsters, we are usually programmed into safe investments like real estate or FDs or something like that. For someone who wants to invest out of the box, what message would you like to give for first-time investors or youngsters?
Yeah, Pooja, for any investor for that matter, be it young or older, the first line of advertisement that hits an investor or a common man is basically that of a broker, right? So you might see a hoarding or an advertisement which says that, you know, buy and sell, your transaction cost is less and make profit and the bagera things, right? However, an investor need to understand that particular advertisement is for just transacting alone. Right. Okay. It doesn't mean that you need to trade. It is so the first thing that a normal human being need to understand is that use a broker as a platform for just your equity transactions. Okay. Right. It doesn't mean that you need to follow whatever he says or she says. Right. Okay. So a broker is a platform where you can buy your shares and you can sell as and when you please. Right. Okay. And the second thing that the particular person need to understand is the real culture of equities. They need to understand what is the real spirit of equity investment, which we covered in the last question, that investment is buying ownership in businesses that you see around. Some of the businesses that you see around are listed in the Indian equity markets, right? Okay. If you feel that these business will do good as we move forward in your normal life, then you can take part in their growth story by investing into shares or equities of these companies, right? So equity investment is simple. So that is the real culture and spirit of investing. So investor need to understand the real spirit and the real culture of equity investment. And the third thing is, every person has got his own character. See, the character pack that Pooja has, it could be much different from what Mr. Apurva has, or for that me.
Absolutely.
So everybody has got a comfort zone, and everyone has got a circle of competence, and everyone has got a character. So choose your, make your investments or choose your investment candidates based on your circle of competence and character. If you move away from your circle of competence, character, or the way you have been brought up in life, then you are bound to do mistakes, because you are getting into a shelter which is not familiar to you. So keep equity investments very familiar to you, because if you are a shopper, so Pooja, if you are a person who would like to go into malls, right? Okay. And you do a lot of indoor shopping, you do your real shopping, then you by automatically, or by birth, or by your character, or by your circle of competence, you will be a good stock picker in consumption stocks. Say for that matter, you know, that Big Bazaar company, or for that matter, Westside, which is a listed company, Tata listed company called Trend, you know, those kind of things. If you are able to relate your real life with equity markets, then investing becomes easy. So these are around a couple of points, or 3 to 4 points, that an investor should keep in mind when they get into equity and equity investing.
Right. So now I did get some idea about how to, for starters, or for people who are investing for the first time. So I am sure a lot of them also got a lot of tips from today's conversation.
And this being a subject of that type, we may want Suraj, as a repeat guest one or more times, because
yes, definitely,
this will be an interesting topic, for a lot of people to really expand and learn more from.
Correct.
So. Thanks, Adan, Suraj. I think this was excellent. In this time, we could cover quite a bit of things, right from how the foreign entities look at, how the Indian markets look like to you, how the shift from the physical assets to financial assets happening. So excellent. I think, a lot to learn for the audience today from this session.
Yes, and ನಮ್ಮ ಕೇಳುಗರಿಗೆಲ್ಲ ಇನ್ನೂ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಶನ್ ಬೇಕಂದ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಮ ರೇಡಿಯೋ ಆ್ಯಪ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವೆಬ್ಸೈಟ್ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ನಿಮಗೆ ಕೆಳಗಡೆ ಒಂದು ಬ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಕಾಣಿಸುತ್ತೆ, ಮೋಡ್ ಫಿನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸಸ್ ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ನಿಮಗೆ ನಾವು ಏನೇನು ಡಿಸ್ಕಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ವೋ ಅದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಇನ್ನೂ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಶನ್ ಬೇಕು ಅಂದರೆ ಅದ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಒಂದು ಕ್ಲಿಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ನಿಮಗೆ ಅವ್ರ ವೆಬ್ಸೈಟ್ಗೆ ರೀಚ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅವ್ರ ಕಾಂಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ಡೀಟೇಲ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಇದೆ. ಸೊ ನೀವು ಈ ಇನ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪೋರ್ಟ್ಫೋಲಿಯೋ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಇನ್ನೂ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಷನ್ ಸಿಗಬೇಕು, ಒನ್ ಟು ಒನ್ ಕಾನ್ವರ್ಸೇಷನ್ ಬೇಕು ಅಂದರೆ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಶೋರ್ಲಿ ಕ್ಲಿಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ವಿಲ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಯು ಔಟ್. ಸೊ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಡೂ ದ್ಯಾಟ್. ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಏನೇ ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಶನ್ ಬೇಕಿದ್ರು ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ ಕ್ಲಿಕ್ ಅವೇ ಇದೆ, ಕ್ಲಿಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಕಾನ್ವರ್ಸೇಷನ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿಗೆ ಎಂಡ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದೀವಿ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್ ಸೂರಜ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅಪೂರ್ವ ಸರ್ ಫಾರ್ ಜಾಯ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಅಸ್ ಟುಡೇ.
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಪೂಜಾ, ಅಪೂರ್ವ,
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಪ್ಲೆಷರ್ ಶೇರಿಂಗ್ ದೋಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಯು.
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್. ಇದು ಮೋಡ್ ಫೈನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸಸ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಮನಿ ಟಾಕ್ಸ್ ವಿತ್ ಮೀ ಪೂಜಾ, ಸೈನಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ ಫಾರ್ ನೌ. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್.
ನಮ್ ರೇಡಿಯೋ ಜಗತ್ತಿನ ಮೊಟ್ಟ ಮೊದಲ ಹಾಗೂ ಏಕೈಕ ಕನ್ನಡ ಆನ್ಲೈನ್ ರೇಡಿಯೋ ಸ್ಟೇಷನ್.